So this weekend's performance honors our veterans. And before I introduce William and his guests, who will share their insights into the pieces they've selected that will celebrate those who serve, I have a few announcements, as you knew I would. So first of all, the league's next fundraiser is our Nothing Bundt cake sale. So many of you are probably familiar with the Nothing Bundt cake store. So next Thursday, the 16th, all cakes that are sold on that day or orders that are placed for pickup that day, 20% of those sales will go to the league. So plan to pick up your cake, phone ahead with your order, and make it your Thanksgiving Day dessert, because you can freeze these and they keep very well, I understand, for up to 8 days. So next Thursday, mark your calendar. Our second fundraiser that's coming up is Marilyn Field is hosting a fashion show that she calls, and hold on, I gotta look at this, Fortissimo Fall Fur Fling and Bling. And that is here at the club also. It's $25. It includes coffee and dessert, probably tea also. Yeah, tea. And it's $25. There will also be a cash bar. And so if you'd rather not spend the afternoon watching the Bears or the Packers or the Vikings, come and spend the afternoon here and with Marilyn and friends. And the third fundraiser that's coming up is something new for the league. And we are hosting a men's euchre night. And that is going to be our first event of the 2024. It's on February 1st, and it's going to be here at the club. And more information will be posted on the DSO website, so look for that also. The other, you're probably all aware that we have two orchestras, the DSO and our DSYO, our youth orchestra. And they just had their fall concert at Clark College, and as I understand it, that hall was full. And maybe you've never been to that to see them perform, but they are quite amazing, and they spend a lot of time practicing. I think they practice every Sunday night, and how many kids dedicate Sunday night to something that they're passionate about? So the winter concert is going to be on January 29th, and I encourage you all to think about attending. I don't think there's even, I think it's a donation.
It depends on the venue.
Oh, okay. So it's at Five Flags. So there's probably a ticket for it. All right. So, but think about coming, because that's a bigger place for them to perform. And when they get up on that stage and they look out at the audience and they see it filled with many people besides mom, dad, grandma, and grandpa, that's pretty inspiring. So, the other, so anyhow, to finish that one up, think about attending that concert. And then the orchestra also takes a tour, I think most years. And this year they're going to Kansas City. You want me to, I'm going to turn this one over to Mark, because this is another fundraiser.
Great.
Well, thank you, Joan. I'm actually going to pull this out. So obviously, and especially with our friends at the Dubuque Symphony Orchestra League, our youth programs are some of the most important things that we do in our community. And as Joan has been describing, we have just shy of about 100 kids in our four youth ensembles. We've got about 35 or 40 in our youth orchestra. And this February, they're going to be traveling to Kansas City to work with the Kansas City Youth Orchestra and then also see a Kansas City Symphony concert. So it's a great opportunity for these high school age students to go and meet students of a similar age, but from a much larger community and a much larger program. It's a great opportunity for them to experience a broader world of music. And it's one of those programs that we do. Our youth orchestra actually goes on tour about every 3 years. It's not every year because it is very expensive. One of the ways that we help fund this will be at our Holiday Pops concert coming up in just a few weeks. And what we do is over intermission, we actually have what we call a stocking stuffer fundraiser, where you as the audience with your dollars help decide what the encore piece and that holiday concert will be. So you'll get to choose with your dollars between playing the Hallelujah Chorus and the Christmas sing-along. So two great favorites. And again, the dollars that are raised from this stocking stuffer will help pay to send these wonderful kids to Kansas City. So anything you can do to reach a little deep to send these kids on this great program, we certainly appreciate it. And we also thank the League because they are also helping to underwrite some of the costs of this tour. So thank you very much, Joan, for the opportunity. And thank you all.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Mark. And as you know, Mark is the executive director of the DSO and helps pull all of this together along with William. So now, that's all I really had. It's time for me to turn this over to William and his guests. May I introduce our music director and maestro, William Intriligator.
Thank you, Joan. Good morning or good afternoon, everybody. It's great to see you all here. Welcome. We're very excited about the program this weekend. It has some fantastic pieces of music with wonderful guests, and it's really, as Joan already mentioned, to honor those who have served, our veterans, on this Veterans Day weekend. And I'll hold this closer. Can you hear me better now?
Yeah.
Okay, there we go. Thank you. Yeah, the program is really to honor veterans, and I know we have many here today. I don't know if you would be willing, if you've served our country, or also in current active military, would you mind standing so we could appreciate you for and thank you for that service? Thank you so much, yeah. We live every day with the freedoms that you have fought to protect, and we don't want to take that for granted. And there's a special way of celebrating that, I think, with some incredible music that can stir the spirit and remind us of what it means to be an American and remind us of these freedoms. So I've put together kind of an unusual program for a regular subscription concert. It's entirely dedicated to this idea of our freedoms and the American spirit. It's entirely music of American composers. It also reflects the diversity of our country with an African-American composer, a woman composer, and many other types of things. I'm really excited about it. We will begin with some very unusual pieces. Before I get to that, I want to introduce a few people. I want to thank our concert co-sponsors, Jim and Jean Gantz, who are here today. Jim, as you just stood up, he's also a veteran, and so it's especially special that you're sponsoring this concert. So thank you to Jim and Jean Gantz for your sponsorship. And I want to thank Mike and Martha Doyle for being our guest artist sponsor from Steel Capital Management. Thank you so much. Thank you. Yeah, we also, during the course of this season, we're going to be selecting a concert master, the lead violinist of the orchestra. And I'm very delighted to have this week with us Madeline Capistrano, an absolutely amazing violinist and leader who will be performing as concertmaster with us this weekend. And I invited her to come here because, as we know, the concertmaster is a very important sort of ambassador for the orchestra in the community. And I thought it would be lovely, if you don't mind, to just invite Madeline to say a few words about herself and let us know who she is. So please welcome Madeline Capistrano.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Oh, here, you want to try? Maybe try mine. Yeah, we'll just switch.
Thanks.
There we go.
Hello. Hi, I'm Madeline Capistrano. Thank you for the introduction, William. I'm delighted to be here in Dubuque as guest concertmaster this week. Really looking forward to this program. It's really special. Both of my grandfathers were veterans. In fact, one was a flautist in the naval band. So,
oh,
yeah. Both passed on now, but it's always special on Veterans Day weekends. I like to remember them. So,
yeah.
A little background about me. I was just telling some folks at my table. It's kind of interesting. I live in Iowa City currently, but I was actually born there. And I moved. I lived there until I was about three. Both of my parents went to the University of Iowa, and then they were living there, and I was born there. But then we moved to Fargo, Fargo-Moorhead, so North Dakota, Minnesota, which is where my mother was from. And then I grew up there and went to high school. So it's kind of interesting that I ended up back in Iowa City now. And in the interim, I did my undergraduate at Michigan State University, and then I did my master's at DePaul University in Chicago. And so I lived in Chicago for about 10 years until moving to Iowa City to be with my partner, who was doing a DMA, the music PhD in trombone. So yeah, made sense to move to Iowa City, and I currently also play in Orchestra Iowa and Des Moines Symphony, and it was just a good move. So I'm enjoying life here in Iowa, and I'm really happy to be here in Dubuque this week for this opportunity.
Well, it's so great. And
thank
we're happy
you.
That you're in Iowa.
That's great.
Welcome back.
Thank you. Kind of bookended my life.
Yeah, right. Well, you're going to be treated to a little solo at the near the very end of the concert with Madeline, something that we just worked out in rehearsal last night, and you sound beautiful, and you're doing such a great job leading the orchestra, so thank you so much for being here.
Thank you. My pleasure.
Yeah. And then we have a few other special guests. We have Amanda Huntleigh is the director of the Dubuque Chorale, and the Dubuque Chorale is featured quite prominently in the program. So we'll be bringing her up and hearing from her shortly. And we also have two narrators to narrate Copland's Lincoln Portrait. And we're very fortunate to have two people who have served our country in the Navy and the Army and to narrate. We have John Beach and Amy Bahl. So welcome. And again, we'll bring them up a little bit and hear from them a little later when we talk about that piece. But the program opens with one of the most iconic pieces of American music, The Fanfare for the Common Man by Aaron Copland. And many of you may already know the story about the origin of this piece, but World War II had just sort of broken out, and a number of composers at that time were commissioned to write short fanfares for the Cincinnati Symphony in the 1942 season. I mean, their commission happened in 1941, and in the 42 season, the Cincinnati Symphony started each concert with a fanfare by an American composer. Copland's was just one of 18, but it's the one that really has stood the test of time. and there's something special about this piece musically, and something, you know, really inspiring about the title as well. Copland himself considered several other titles. I think it might be mentioned in your program notes. Some of them are like Fanfare for the Spirit of Democracy, or Fanfare for the Rebuilding of this Czech Village that the Nazis had just decimated. But he was also influenced by a book that had just come out at the time that's called The Century of the Common Man, and talked about how it was really the heroism of everyday people, men and women, who kind of brought America to that point of where they were. And it's exactly what Copland wanted to represent in this fanfare. He said, you know, it really is the common man and women who are fighting in the, you know, overseas right now, who are deserving of this fanfare and this tribute. And so he really had in mind that he wrote this piece for the military people who are serving, but also just the common man. So it's such a perfect way to start this program. You know, and I say it's iconic because, I mean, it's been used by Emerson, Lake and Palmer and the Rolling Stones and numerous, you know, Olympics and sports events and so forth. But there's something about it that evokes that spirit of heroism and strength. And it's just something that's hard to put into words when you hear this. Of course, it does start with quite a loud percussion to announce it. But what's also interesting is that, you know, going back even farther, the concept of a fanfare is, you know, it has its origins not just as a sort of military kind of musical thing for moving troops, but to announce royalty. And so from going back a long ways, fanfares were kind of more about a sort of elite type of person. And Copeland wanted to dedicate this fanfare and have this fanfare be for the common man. So that was another kind of breaking from the past in the tradition of fanfares. But here's a little bit of how it goes if you're not familiar with it. The percussion starting it, and then the trumpets coming in, then more brass instruments and more brass instruments join in, the French horns and the trumpets, and then the trombones, and the timpani itself gets a sort of special solo moment later on, playing boom, 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 in a very, you know, powerful, almost kind of like, I don't know, it's just stirring and very moving kind of sense of musical heroism. This piece has all the kind of musical ingredients of a lot of Copeland's music. So when we think of Copeland's music, we think of his most famous pieces, his ballets from the 1930s, like Appalachian Spring and Rodeo and Billy the Kid and things like that. Of course, he wrote a lot of styles of music over a very long life. I mean, he lived from 1900 to 1990. And in his 20s, he wrote more avant-garde music or some symphonic jazz music. And then later in life, he even dabbled in 12-tone music. But those pieces from the 1930s that have that sort of quintessential Copeland sound, a lot of them are built up on certain intervals, melodically spread out, that are kind of his signature. And that is right here in the trumpets, too. So we have these stacked fourths and things that you'll hear also in the other pieces of Copeland on the program this weekend as well. So it's sort of quintessentially Copeland. It's interesting that he thought that maybe this piece wouldn't really be played very much after the premiere in Cincinnati. And so he incorporated a few years later into the finale of his third symphony. It's proved the test of time as the fanfare is performed way more actually than the Third Symphony. The Third Symphony is a great masterpiece, one of the great American symphonies, perhaps the greatest. But this fanfare kind of stands alone. And when you hear it in the symphony, you're like, oh, that's the fanfare for the common man. That shouldn't even be here or something like that. But it does provide a rousing end to a symphony too. So then you fast forward to 1986, 1987, and the American composer Joan Tower was asked by the Houston Symphony to write a fanfare. And so she got to thinking about other orchestral fanfares and the sort of tradition of that. And she loved Copeland's music. She loved the fanfare for the common man, but that title always bothered her. She was just, at that time in the 1980s, she was reading a lot of feminism books. She was saying she was in the midst of reading a lot of books about feminism, and there was something that just sort of got, didn't sit right with her, with that title. So she came up with this fanfare for the uncommon woman and dedicated it to adventurous, risk-taking women everywhere. And it's quite, yes, that's great, yes. Over the course of about 30 years, she actually composed six of these fanfares, calling them parts 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, different instrumentations, but the first one, which we're performing this weekend, has the same, essentially the same instrumentation as the Copeland fanfare for the common man. And so with the brass and percussion, although a lot more percussion than what fanfare or than what Copeland used in his fanfare. So this one is very exciting. It's a little bit different spirit than the Copeland fanfare for the common man, but they work really well together, like two sort of sides of the same coin in a way. There is something that Joan Tower has captured about the American spirit and that adventurous, risk-taking spirit of all people, but especially women, in this piece. I'll play for you a little bit of how this one sounds. It's a really wonderful high-energy piece. In fact, Joan Tower has said that she really likes creating music that sort of pushes the bounds of like intensity and high energy. And she does that in this piece. It's so interesting because when you see interviews with her, she's such a lovely lady. And you know, it just goes to show, you know, whether a man composer or a woman composer, there's music that they write that is not necessarily reflective of their personality, but it's in them. And there's just something wonderful about this piece. But I encourage you to go on YouTube and maybe check out some interviews with Joan Tower, because if you hear this music and then you see the interview, you're like, wow. There's just some, not a disconnect, but it's just that it's wonderful that this, you know, lovely lady, this wonderful pianist, this great composer, one of our most honored living American composers, really, has such an incredible intensity about her music, too. It's just fascinating. I love it. She's written a lot of other great pieces. I'm hoping that we can perform more of her music. As you probably read in the program note, part of her childhood was spent in South America, and that influenced some of the style of her composition in terms of some of the rhythm, some of the kind of intensity of that as well. So really excited to have Joan Tower's fanfare as a sort of foil, if you will, to the Copeland, a sort of complement to the Copeland fanfare to start the program. And then after that, we're going to go to another piece of Aaron Copland, his Canticle of Freedom. And this is one that features the Dubuque Chorale. I'm going to ask Amanda to join me up here. She's, as I mentioned, the artistic director of the Dubuque Chorale. And she's been in that position for, I think, 5 or 6 years now. Five. Yeah. So please welcome Amanda Huntleigh. Amanda, tell us about your background a little bit before we get into the chorale and then this piece by Copeland. But tell us a little about who you are and how long you've been here in Dubuque.
So this is my sixth season. I just started my sixth season, both as a professor at Clark University and as the artistic director of the Dubuque Chorale. So I moved to Dubuque 6 years ago-ish. Before that, I grew up in Normal, Illinois, about 3 hours away from here. So I am a Midwestern girl, though not a Dubuquer. And I did my undergraduate at Wartburg College, my master's degree in choral conducting at George Mason University in Fairfax, Virginia, and then my doctorate is in choral conducting from the University of Washington in Seattle. So,
wow.
I chose the Midwest after spanning both coasts.
Oh, that's great.
So I have a little bit of a movement background related to conducting, and I love working with community singers because I like my college job too, don't get me wrong, but there's something really special about people that continue to choose to sing and make music together beyond their youth that is just really special, and they have a maturity and a life experience about them that they bring to these performances that's just really great.
That's really special. A number of the Dubuque Chorale members are here with us today. Would you mind standing if you're in the Dubuque Chorale or if you have ever been in the Dubuque Chorale?
I know this sound.
There we go. There they are. Put you on the spot. Sorry about that, but thank you. Some of you are performing with us this weekend. We appreciate that. Amanda, you mentioned something about a movement background. Could you elaborate on that a little bit?
Yes. So I am a Laban Bartenieff movement specialist, just to give you as many weird words as possible. But it's a way of describing and looking at movement. So not just what people are doing, but how they're moving. So it can really help people dig into creating different shapes and sounds with their voices, but also help people just as they kind of move around in their daily life. So my students will tell you in my voice studio, they have to move a lot. And sometimes I ask the chorale to move a little. They're a little less open than the but they put up with all of my moving around. So it's just a really special way to dig into conducting and to dig into singing.
Yeah. Well, Amanda, you share my love of the great orchestra, choral, symphonic masterpieces. And, you know, one of the things that's a challenge with our small stage at Five Flags Theater is to find the right piece to do. And, you know, sometimes several years go by because we just can't fit it all. And we are actually having kind of a challenge this week, in fact, fitting the large chorus and orchestra on stage. And I understand some of the, like the altos who are right behind the trumpets and trombones are having a little bit of a hard time. And so are the trumpets and trombones. So it's a little bit close quarters here on the stage. From your perspective, tell us a little bit about, what are some of the challenges for in terms of that, in terms of fitting it on the stage, as well as preparing this piece, these pieces?
So singers tend to get accustomed to the sounds that they have around them. And one of the challenges of moving into any space is changing from the space that you're practicing in to the space that you're performing in. So that can be something as simple as we were practicing in four rows and now we're in three rows. So the person that was behind me isn't behind me anymore. Instrumentalists have the benefit of being able to push keys and make notes come out, whereas singers have to rely entirely on their ear and muscle memory to make that happen. So it just creates an extra challenge. And my instrumental students will agree that sight singing is harder than sight reading for that very reason. So any instrumentalist in the room can probably nod. And so that's one of the challenges. The other challenge is one of the things that we have that instruments do not is the ability to communicate text. That's the main reason that we're there. Yes, the pitches are pretty too, but if we don't communicate a message and there's a message there to communicate that, then we're not doing all of our job. So being able to enunciate so clearly that over the orchestra, you do not hear this, you hear us instead of the trumpet.
Yes, exactly.
It's just a lot more work, and it's an unnatural way to speak, and it's a kind of unnatural way to sing. So when we do preparation for choral orchestral works, I'm harping on them about consonants all the time.
Yes. And this particular...
Confirmed
by current chorale members, yes. So this particular concert, I didn't give you like a well-known text to latch onto. The chorale is singing in two pieces. One of them has no text. We'll talk about that in a minute. It's just a wordless chorus. Mm-hmm. And the other has a text based on a Scottish poem from the 1340s, we think, and it's about freedom. It's a heroic poem by a Scottish poet, John Barbour, slightly adapted with some of the language updated, but really not all of
it. Not enough.
Not enough. Perhaps not enough. But it extols the virtues of freedom itself. And so this canticle of freedom that Copeland wrote... that I think it probably posed a kind of a challenge for you and the chorale members to sort of really get into it, just to get past, like to get into the words and the music of it. Tell us about that.
So freedom is a noble thing. Freedom makes man to have liking. Freedom all solace to man gives. You know, the way we normally speak. there's also a line that talks about thraldom, which we all had to look up.
Yep.
But honestly, the choir was struggling quite a lot getting into this piece because of the obscurity of the text and because words like freedom, even though they're really clear to us, they're kind of hard to sing about, even as they're easy to speak about. It was when William came into our rehearsal that it really clicked for a lot of the singers, because he was able to give some of the background information about the composition of the piece and help them understand a little bit more of the emotional underpinning and how it connects with the instrument. Because the vocal lines, while melodic, are a little bit isolated without
the orchestra.
The orchestra.
Yeah, the orchestra plays a huge part. Yeah.
Yeah.
In fact, the orchestra has a long introduction before the chorus even comes in. And the orchestra sort of explores its own kind of journey about freedom in a weird way. I just want to clarify a little bit of what Amanda was saying. So one of the things that I think helped the chorale understand it was that when this piece was written, this was in the 1950s. And Copland's Lincoln portrait, which is also on this program, was initially selected to be performed at the inauguration of President Eisenhower. Then Copland, for his sort of liberal leanings, was thought, oh, maybe he has something to do with the communists. And then that that piece, Lincoln Portrait, was taken off from the presidential inauguration. That really upset Copland, of course. And then he was actually called before the Committee on American Activities and Senator McCarthy and everybody else and questioned and asked to name names. Copland kept his dignity and answered very, you know, kind of wonderfully and didn't, name names and he didn't have anything to be ashamed for. But the whole experience was very trying and put a cast over Copland and his composition and his activities and his commissions and his appearances and his guest conducting and so forth. And then MIT, the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, commissioned this piece for their choir and orchestra to be performed in their new Kresge Auditorium and chapel. By the way, the chapel is where my parents were married. They were both students at MIT at the time, so it was kind of a neat connection there. It's a really cool... Both of those buildings were by the amazing Finnish architect Eero Saarinen. They're incredible buildings architecturally. So at the inauguration of these two buildings, they wanted a special piece. And knowing that Copland had just been through sort of the ringer here and had sort of not the greatest, you know, perhaps public image, some people weren't sure what to think about Copland, they decided to sort of give him a little bit of a backing there and asked him to write this piece that then was performed in 1955. And when you realize that it came out of that context of Senator McCarthy, by the way, is Scottish last name,
oh,
right?
Yeah,
in the Scottish
I didn't
poem.
Make that connection.
So that we have this Scottish poem about freedom, and it's over the top. It's just over the top. There's not much else to say about it. Even the orchestra introduction, it kind of gets crazy at times. And it's almost as if it's Copland's response to what he had been through. But it's a thrilling, exciting, amazing piece. When you hear it, when the chorus is just preparing their part alone, it's missing something. It's like what you said. Their part is not skeletal, but it's just one component. The orchestra is incredibly important in this piece. Mm-hmm. And again, we play for, the orchestra performs for probably 8 or 9 minutes maybe before the chorus comes in singing this Scottish poem about freedom. But then the two together is just very stirring and very powerful. So yeah, that was a little bit, I think, of what I may have shared at the chorus rehearsal.
And it really wasn't until we got together with the orchestra that we were able to capture the combination of nobility and joy. We had nobility, that part, we were very serious, but there is this kind of
ecstatic exuberance, over the topness.
Yeah, yeah. That really isn't captured in the vocal line alone, but once you're singing it with the orchestra, it's really clear that underpins his sense of freedom.
Yeah, exactly. And the piece is not performed as often as it probably should be, but it does have some challenges, I think. The orchestra part is not easy. It has a lot of ways of challenging the players, and Madeline and I are kind of looking at each other like, yeah. It's tricky. It is tricky. But I'm really excited to perform it. I think it fits really well in this program, And I've just come to really be super excited about it. Like, yeah. It's just something that is so over the top. I think the audience is going to love it, actually. You can get past the kind of obscurity of some of the words, and you can understand the meaning of the words just by the music itself and the singing, even if you're not focused on every little word that they're saying. Yeah, I think it's going to be really special. Anything
Agreed.
Else you want to add to that about that?
I did not know this piece until William introduced this piece to me, and I am so pleased that you did.
Yay.
So
thank
I'm
you.
Excited for the weekend.
Oh, thank you. Mm-hmm. Well, and then we have another piece with the chorale, the Wordless Chorus, and this is one...
Our words are perfect on that.
Yes. The diction is amazing. That's right. So this is a really special piece, and I just think there's so much heart in this piece, too. So this is an excerpt from the soundtrack from Saving Private Ryan, the film from 1998. It actually was in the final credits of the film. The film, one of the many things special about that incredibly powerful film was the sort of lack of music for a lot of it. John Williams wanted something special for the final credits while people were kind of reflecting on what they just saw. So I think there was something just absolutely brilliant in John Williams' choice to have a chorus, have a sort of human kind of heart element to something, so it's not just an orchestra. But then there's also something brilliant in the fact that he has the chorus singing without words. There's two things about that. For me personally, I feel like it makes it universal. It's not in a particular language. But it also feels as though the chorus is trying to speak to us, almost like, this is again just my interpretation, like beyond, from beyond. Like, there's something, this is a hymn to the fallen, people who have died in service. But there's something about those voices without the presence of text that makes it feel like there's some comforting from some, I don't know, spiritual realm or something like that, if you will. Sorry to go deep.
No, I didn't know where you were going to go.
Yeah. We hadn't talked about that. I didn't mention it to the chorus, and I probably should at one of our warm-ups here this weekend.
I mean, I think about it a little. I love that. I also think about it a little bit about how when people are grieving, especially with catastrophic loss, it's often hard to know what you should say. Like, we all know what we're feeling, but we don't know... often don't have the right words.
Right.
What would be the right words? So instead of trying to find the right words that wouldn't capture the totality of the meaning,
so true.
We just say it through the music.
Yes. That is so, so true, too. I love that. So some of you might be thinking, well, this is a piece perhaps more in line with a concert for Memorial Day rather than Veterans Day. But kind of speaking to something that Madeline was brought up, which I'm really glad you did. So for many of us on Veterans Day, we think of our family members and friends who have passed, who were veterans but didn't die in action. And they sort of sometimes slip through the cracks. We don't honor them at Armed Forces Day because they're not current military. We don't sometimes think of them as Veterans Day because they're not with us anymore. They're not honored at Memorial Day because they didn't die in duty. But many of us have so many people who this is another Veterans Day is another opportunity to remember them. So that's one of the reasons why I wanted to put this piece on, besides it's just a favorite piece of mine. It's just so gorgeous. Is there anything else you wanted to add to that?
No.
No? Anything other challenges from your standpoint, from the chorus standpoint, or?
Part of my job as the vocal specialist is to interpret what instrumentalists mean when they ask things of vocalists. Because just as if I were writing something for a string player, I might ask for something that would be perhaps unattainable or just ill-advised. Sometimes composers do the same thing to vocalists. I joke about the diction, but the biggest challenge of this piece vocally was trying to honor the stylistic markings printed in the music when the vowel choices prohibit those stylistic markings. You can't actually crescendo on an ooh.
So most of the time they are singing ooh.
You can't. Ooh. Like, I'm up there trying, like, okay, so we had to do some modifying to capture the energy in volume and in tone that was that both William and John Williams wanted, while maybe not being so true to the printed ooh,
ooh
on the page.
Yeah.
You can't go from a piano to a forte on an ooh. You have to give some a vowel with more space and more substance.
Like
to
an
be
ah.
Like an ah, which he gets to eventually.
We do.
But there's just been some adjustments that you make as a specialist. You know, you write bowings in that make more sense than what somebody else might do. And
I'm so glad you brought that up.
Thing.
Yeah. You know, in my experience working with you and the other directors of the Chorale over the years that I've been here, and just whenever I get to work with a vocal soloist or when we've done operas here,
mm-hmm.
I just am so, it really is interesting how much it's a completely different language. We're like all classically trained musicians.
Right.
But between the vocal realm and the instrumental realm, it's a huge difference in how you talk about things and how you interpret certain things on the page.
Mm-hmm.
You asked to see a copy of my score to Hymn
yes.
to the Fallen. And so it was a score that I had used years ago. I hadn't looked at it in years, but it had my markings from years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And there was one part where I put something that would be interpreted one way by an instrumentalist.
Exactly what he said.
She did exactly what I said. So
he didn't see it that
there's
way.
This one section where the choir has to sing quarter notes instead of longer notes that they had been singing. So I put these long lines over them. So I was trying to make a note to myself that I wanted it to not seem like da ba da. But in the vocal realm, that ended up being at the first rehearsal, ha, 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 ha. Like, wow, okay.
We
you
adjusted.
Really did look at my score.
I
and
looked
we,
at his score. I wrote every marking in my score. I followed it to the letter until he told me I'd misinterpreted it.
I know. I'm sorry. It's just one of those things. Even sometimes the markings we use between instrumentalists
yeah.
and vocalists mean different things. So thank you for being so diligent. You were really right on. And then I had to like change
okay.
all the work that you did and do it. They are very flexible. We really are grateful to partner with you guys. It's always wonderful. There's a spirit that the Chorale brings to the stage that is really special, and we look forward to featuring you also at the holiday concerts too.
Yes. Yes.
I'd love to have Amanda tell us how people could join the Chorale.
Oh, yes.
Oh.
Yeah.
You do not have to audition to join the Chorale. It is the people that you see on stage, some of them audition for our smaller group, but most the people on stage do not audition. You can go to DubuqueChorale.org and there's a sign up sheet, or you can talk to me afterward and I'll take your name down and get you any information you need. But we are deep in the throes of rehearsing for the holiday concert as well. But we will start up again the second Thursday in January, and we take new members at the beginning of every semester. I'm a professor, so I still think in semesters. January is a new semester, and you can join us for our spring program if you're interested. So I'd love to talk to you afterward.
That would be great. Thank you, Amanda.
Thanks, Mark.
I'm really grateful for your leadership.
Thank you.
Great job. We're very lucky to have the Dubuque Chorale and Amanda's wonderful leadership of that group, and it's great to partner with them. Yeah. After intermission, we'll have two pieces, another piece of Copland. And you might be thinking, three pieces of Copland, William? Really? You know he's one of my favorites, right? I've been doing this long enough, and we've performed so much of his music over my time, but I couldn't resist bringing back Lincoln Portrait. For me, it's one of Copland's greatest pieces. I mean, all of these are great pieces. Fanfare for the Common Man, Canticle of Freedom. Lincoln Portrait is so special. And it had its origins very much like the origin of the Fanfare for the Common Man. The conductor was asking for pieces by only three great American composers to take words by other great Americans and create a musical portrait again, during World War II, to help lift people's spirits. And so this was, I'm trying to think of the order between Fanfare for the Common Man and this one. I'm suddenly not sure, but I think maybe this came after. Originally, Copland was going to choose the poetry of Walt Whitman and create a musical portrait of Walt Whitman. But actually, at the urging of the conductor, Castellanets, he went with Lincoln. Lincoln's was having a sort of resurgence of respect and kind of attention at that time, with the country being in World War II and facing one of its greatest challenges. A lot of people were reflecting on the Civil War. The two-volume biography of Sandburg of Lincoln had just come out. The great statue in the Lincoln Memorial had just been put there. The memorial building was there, but then the statue was there. It was Mount Rushmore was in process. A lot of things about Lincoln were happening at that time, and so Castellanos didn't have to twist Copeland's arm. Copeland loved this idea. But he gave himself a little special challenge. He said, if I'm going to use some of Lincoln's words, some of them are so famous, I think I'm going to restrict myself to not hardly any of his famous speeches. And so the only part of this Lincoln portrait, the words of Lincoln that you will probably recognize, is the very end. He couldn't resist using the end of the Gettysburg Address. And it's just so moving and so powerful. And again, appropriate also on Veterans Day, talking about those who gave their life at that battlefield and then his hope for a rebirth of freedom. But the other texts are ones that will make you think and kind of almost sometimes scratch your head and like, I didn't realize he said that. So there are some really interesting things that Copeland chose. He chose portions of a debate with Douglas, you know, Lincoln-Douglas debates, yeah, and some of his other lesser-known speeches. I'd like to invite our two narrators to come and join me and tell us a little bit about themselves and tell us what it's like to speak Lincoln's words and with this powerful music in the background. So, please welcome Sergeant Amy Bahl and Lieutenant John Beach. Tell us a little bit about your backgrounds first. Amy, you want to start?
Right.
Welcome.
I'm Amy, and I served in the National Guard, Army National Guard, for 10 years. I made sergeant. I had many hats in the National Guard, so two of my MOSs, which are jobs, I was a dental specialist, and then my main job was actually a combat medic. So, I enjoyed it. I loved it. I still miss it today. We deployed on many different missions. We were like in Belize, different, you know, humanitarian missions, and even stateside and Davenport and everything. But the main one, I was in Iraq from 2003 to 2004. And my main job was a combat medic there too. I did do both jobs, but that was the main job.
Wow.
So
thank you for your service.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
and now tell us what you're involved in, because you still have a hand sort of in the military. Tell us about that.
I do. I am 100% disabled through the VA, so I cannot hold the job anymore. So instead of not being able to work in the community, I help with all different veterans issues. So right now I'm currently the DAV commander for our chapter here in Dubuque. I am also the state DAV commander for the state of Iowa. I do lots of talking and veterans' behalf to get things done. And with the VFW, I'm the senior vice commander there. I file claims for veterans to help them get the disabilities that they need and they deserve, the care that they need. So, yeah, I stay pretty busy.
That's wonderful. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Well, thank you, Amy, for that. I'm John. I'll come see you for some better things I need taken care of personally.
Come see me.
Yeah. My name is John Beach. So, William said, I will be one of the narrators for the Lincoln portrait. So, a little bit about me. I was actually born in the Philippines. So, I became an Americanized citizen, did some island hopping from there to Japan, to Guam, and then I ended up in Illinois. So... Lived in Illinois.
Like Lincoln.
Yeah.
We were all thinking it.
Yes. So I grew up in Illinois, and then I had the pleasure of going to the Naval Academy and graduated in 2013. Once I commissioned, I became a surface warfare officer and drove a couple ships. The first one was bomber chart in Japan, which I don't know if you pay attention to the news, but it recently burned down in San Diego a few years ago. Yeah. But, you know, home for a couple of years. My second ship was in Bahrain. It was a minesweeper. But I had not so great a time in Bahrain. But I won't get into the details of that. I ended up leaving the Navy at the end of 2017 and decided to pursue a degree in electrical engineering. Should have noted. My first degree was in computer science. Went to electrical engineering. Now I'm a software developer at the John Deere facility, which is kind of... It's been an interesting track of life. I used to drive ships, now I drive trucks.
That's great.
But yeah, so I mentioned my job. So the things I do, I actually compete nationally in fencing, trying to go to nationals again for the next year, and just pretty tight season, but get into the details if you want to ask. But so with regards to what I'm doing now, so I do work with Amanda in the corral, and we put on a bunch of shows, and they've all gone really well, in my opinion. So,
were you involved in music at Annapolis, at the Naval Academy?
So, all right, funny story with that. I kind of stopped doing music when I was in college the first time around. When I was in high school, however, had an interesting childhood. So my dad was really into having both of his sons play musical instruments. My brother was gifted, saxophone, guitar, a little bit of a singer, but he did all of that. I ended up doing maybe half of that because my instrument was clarinet. I did a little bit of guitar, but I don't have the skills and ability that my brother had. Like, he can tune to a very precise degree, a couple hertz of, like, properly in tune, which is crazy. But yeah, I ended up doing band for all that time, and just I kind of made myself more of an athlete. So I did the football game and then the halftime show. So imagine.
So you had to do both.
Yeah.
Wow,
so
that's impressive.
Imagine marching and then you wear your football pads and then you're just like steaming everywhere. So.
Wow. Oh, that's pretty impressive.
Yeah. But I really. So, funny story. Japan was a great time. I ended up doing a lot of karaoke.
That's where the singing came in. It's very popular.
It is very popular. However, it's also very expensive because, like, you can end up spending 200 yen per song, which I spent a lot.
Really?
I'm not proud of that, but at the same time, I also do it a little bit here in Dubuque as, like, a hobby, but also just kind of the nightlife here. So it's a fun time.
Are some of your favorite songs to sing karaoke?
Oh boy.
Sorry to put you on the spot.
So Billy Joel's Piano Man, Trains, Drops of Jupiter, and Jason Mraz's I'm Yours.
Wow. Those are good choices.
Right.
Yeah.
It's not so much I pick those three exclusively, it's just songs that I can find my range for, but I do other pieces, and sometimes it's just like, oh hey, you go back to Disney songs and you're doing duets because that's kind of what calls for.
Yeah.
So
that's so cool. So then you've been in the corral for a few years.
Yes. I actually am about to reach my 2-year anniversary at work, so I just joined a year ago, ended up meeting Amanda, and I do the chorale, I do the cadenza, so like the premier group that the chorale has where you can sing very particular pieces, which is a very fun time, in my opinion. So
yeah,
it's great. It's been a couple years, but never did I think I would be here as a special guest for a Lincoln portrait.
Cool. Well, welcome. Thank you for your service too.
Thank you.
Yeah. So maybe you could both tell us a little bit about what it's like to speak these words of Lincoln. Of course, there are a couple of other interjections of words like, that is what he said. Copeland liked to frame the Lincoln words with his own little texts, sometimes about, you know, he was born in Kentucky, raised in Indiana, lived in Illinois, and this is what he said. He said, so the narrators say that type of thing a lot. All those words are Copeland himself. But then there's all this text of Lincoln. What has it been like to speak that?
Those are the easy words. It's actually a lot of fun. It's nothing that I what I thought it was going to be. I figured, because I've actually never heard of this piece before until you, and I listened to it, and I thought, oh, it'll be like the Gettysburg Address. It'll be all these really famous words that everybody would know. No, it is not. Not really, because I didn't recognize hardly any of them, like you said, until the end.
Yeah.
And the way that they spoke back then is so different than now. And it's some of the words, it's like a tongue twister trying to get them out.
Yeah.
So
we must disenthrall ourselves, and then we shall save our country.
Yeah,
it's
like,
not
really
easy to say some of these things.
No.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
But if you, just by reading and listening to the music over and over, the words sink in. And then it really, it gets you thinking, to like, oh, yeah.
Yeah.
You know, what he said, they're not the most famous or anything, but it's like, oh, they're pretty powerful.
They're powerful
yeah.
and deep words. Yeah, Copeland chose some really great ones. I mean, obviously, there's so much of Lincoln that's great to choose from. But you're right. And I've been conducting this piece for probably, like, almost 30 years. I've done it off and on. And each time there's like another layer of the meaning of the words and or just a nuance. And even in our conversations, the three of us, where we're talking about should that be the emphasized word or should that be the emphasized word, and it brings out a whole nother meaning. And so there's just, it's like peeling layers of an onion. There's so much depth to these speeches of Lincoln. And what's interesting also is that I was just rereading something that said that in the time of Lincoln, he was considered to not be a great, like, orator, and that his words were almost too direct and simple compared to the flowery language of many other politicians and statesmen and women. Or, you know, at that time, they used much more flowery language than what he used. So I guess it's a blessing because it's already hard enough with the simple words that Lincoln chose.
Yes.
Because, like, as an example, I guess at that Gettysburg, you know, when Lincoln gave the Gettysburg Address, he was not the featured speaker that day. There was another featured speaker who spoke for 2 hours with the most sort of very, very fancy, very sort of floral kind of language, very like highfalutin kind of sound. And then Lincoln spoke for 2 minutes. So the one spoke for 2 hours, the other spoke for 2 minutes. And it's just very interesting that the way that the two speeches were written, if you compare them, is so different than that Lincoln's is more direct and simple but powerful in its meaning, very deep. Sorry to like go
oh, no.
on that. John, what are you feeling? Because you seem to have a really strong connection with some of these words too. Like you had like different ways that you're bringing it out, and I was like, oh, that's cool.
Yeah. Well, so it traces back to my childhood. So my father had expectations: one, for me to be a musician; two, to access my dictionary like anytime I had a word I need to look up. And I spent many a time doing that. It's just what Amanda said reminded me of that.
Yeah,
thraldom.
thraldom.
Right. So this also just reminded me of like my first year at the Naval Academy. There are three things that you memorize. One is the mission of the Naval Academy. So development, shipment, morally, mentally, and physically, etc. Man in the Arena, which is in summation a story about grit, which with a bunch of featured celebrities these days. I don't know if you've heard of Lindsey Stirling. Tom Brady for sure is special as Navy Man in the Arena. And then a bunch of gyms just have it like posted on the wall. So cool thing. And then the qualifications of a naval officer. So those things were the expectations for developing yourself as a leader. Lincoln Portrait kind of resonated with me in that respect because they are flowery words. They're also pieces of direct words that need to be spoken because it needed to be exhibited that we of the nation, we of this Congress and this administration play onto that. Like we, the people as well, need to just better ourselves. That's just the ultimate mission. That's kind of the message that I got from it, because we can be better people as citizens, better people as leaders, better people as those responsible and those who served.
Yeah, absolutely. That's wonderful. before the narrators come in, the orchestra paints a musical portrait of Lincoln and the times he lived in. And it's kind of a lengthy introduction. Copeland uses some of his traditional kind of musical elements, the sort of signature seeds of musical seeds that I've been talking about. But he also uses one of the things that is sort of a characteristic Copeland trademark of using folk songs, quoting them, also kind of making a variation of a folk song, a slightly different version of a well-known folk song, maybe cast in a different light or a very different tempo. He does that. And then he has an original thing that sounds like a folk song, but it's actually his own original song. And so we have all three of those in that piece. He quotes Camptown Races. So you'll hear Camptown Races, and that was a very popular Stephen Foster song in the 1850s, so it was right at that time. And it's part of the context of the introduction that's sort of depicting life in the 1840s, 1850s of Lincoln. So it's kind of a fun little moment in the piece. But then he also quotes, in a weird way, the song Springfield Mountain. So that's, of course, there's a tie-in with Springfield and, of course, with Lincoln. But the Springfield Mountain folk song, normally it goes, on Springfield Mountain there did dwell a youth I knew so well, oh well. But what Lincoln or Copeland does with it is he slows it down and creates it like this beautiful nostalgic memory of something that's so heartfelt. And he wanted it to show the gentler side of Lincoln's personality. And it's just absolutely gorgeous when you hear it slowed down like that. So, and then when the narrators come up, they are announced by this large, like, gong, tam-tam hit, and you know something special is going to happen. And the way that Copeland frames the narration with the words and has them work in synergy is really special, too. You guys have been doing a great job. I know you're both out of your comfort zone doing this, but it was really special to have two veterans to be able to narrate this, and Army and Navy working together.
I know.
It's so amazing. Yes.
We're still better.
Right. Give it a couple of weeks and we'll see.
Thank you both so much for everything you're doing. Is there anything else you want to add?
No. Well,
it looks like I cut you off there, so I'm sorry.
No, no worries. Yeah. But I'll echo what you said. Thank you again for your service. It's nice to see everybody here for today. There's also someone who passed away a few years ago for me, so not a little bit of Memorial Day pieces, a little bit of Veterans Day pieces. He was a close personal friend when I went to the Academy, so
yeah,
does mean a lot to me. So thank you, William.
Thank you. Thank you both so much.
Yeah, I just want to say thank you for the opportunity to do this. I think it's really awesome, so I can't wait for this weekend.
Well,
it'll be
fun. We appreciate you doing
that. And
thank
you, veterans, too.
Yes.
There.
Yeah, exactly. Thank you.
Thank you.
Joan has a few parting gifts, it looks like.
For us? Oh.
Maybe.
Awesome. We get
personal
gifts.
So, the League would like to thank you for joining us today. We know your weekend here is very busy with your individual preparation, your group practices, and now I understand your other jobs. And we do appreciate you spending the time with us. You made this event more enjoyable and certainly educational, and we look forward to hearing you this weekend and seeing you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Wonderful.
You can have
sorry, Madeline. We didn't plan this.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
So great. Well, with so many wonderful special guests here, we've run out of time for me to tell you a little bit about Duke Ellington's The River Suite. You'll have to come to the Sunday pre-concert lecture if you're coming to that concert. I'll spend some more time on it, but I will just say that this is a piece that, in a way, also embodies the American spirit. Duke Ellington, one of our greatest musicians that this country ever produced, one of the absolute leaders in the world of jazz, of course, but many people may not realize he wrote many symphonic pieces. And this is one of, I think, his most powerful and special and moving ones. He uses the idea of a river as an allegory for life, and as sort of almost like a religious allegory too, but from birth and all the various journeys that we go on into a finally sort of heaven kind of thing. And it was originally a ballet. I know I'm out of time, so I'm not going to get into the details of it, but I will just say that the American spirit is strong in this piece. And it's going to be a great thing to remind us
of you know, what the veterans have fought to protect, the freedoms that we have, and what makes our country unique. And so thank you all so much for being here. Thank you to the Dubuque Symphony Orchestra League and the Country Club. And we'll see you this weekend.
Thank you.